So I think I am the only odd man out because amongst all the oculoplastic surgeons. So please bear with me. So I'll just share a few cases which were referred to me as intraocular mask lesions, but on clinical examinations and various other things, we saw that no, it is not a intraocular tumor, it was something else. So this presentation is basically to see what we learned from each of those cases. So the first case is an elderly gentleman who was referred as a melanotic melanoma with a poor vision of counting fingers of 1 meter. So if you look closely, that's it's a two-dimensional picture, but if you look closely, this lesion looks very much a flat lesion. It is not at all elevated. And if you see in the first picture as the arrow points, there's multiple small granular yellowish deposits at the edge of the lesions. And the lesion is mostly subretinal. You can see the retinal vessels flowing over it. So it is a subretinal, it is not a choroidal lesion. It's a subretinal lesions. In the second picture on the top left, which the arrow shows, you can see multiple edge of heme at the edge of the lesions. And again, small granular deposit. So in such flat lesions, it is best not to have an ultrasound, but to have other modalities like FFA, OCT, or angio. So the patient underwent the ICG investigations, and you can clearly see two small hyperfluorescence lesions in the ICG, which are polypoidal lesions. So the best treatment for this is no anti-VEGF injection, just laser to these polyps since it is away from the fovea. And this is what we achieved after 2 months of just doing laser to that patient, and the patient recovered 6x24 vision. So the learning point from this case was, we should always remember that choroidal melanoma is a very slow-growing and gradual progressive lesion. They will never present to us in a sudden onset condition, except if it is a spontaneously necrotic melanoma. Most important, a melanotic melanoma is a misnomer. Even in a melanotic melanoma, you will have some amount of pigmentations which are found. And the takeaway, most important point is, in a flat lesion, especially which is 2 to 3 millimeters there, it is always best to have an OCT and angio and not to have an ultrasound. MRI is also useful where you want to differentiate between a hemorrhage and a tumor. The second case is the most common referral case that I get, is a tumor which is seen by the ophthalmologist. But if you see the surface of the tumor as marked by the star, as well as the arrow, the surface is absolutely smooth. And at the edge is also clear, and you have multiple choroidal folds which are seen. So this is basically a tumor which is present in the orbit and compressing the retina, causing a pseudo mass effect. So not all lumps and bumps that you see are basically intraocular mass. The take-home point from this is, watch for these choroidal folds. If these choroidal folds convexity points towards the ONH, the lesion is intraconal. And if this convexity of the choroidal folds is away from the optic nerve, and it is away, then the lesion is mostly extraconal lesions. And so the choroidal folds, if you look clearly, gives a vast clue to us as to what the pathology and where the pathology is. My last case is one of the most interesting case, is that this is a case of a young lady, maybe she was 39 to 40 years old, who has a history of breast carcinoma and is on chemotherapy currently, and she presented with sudden onset visual diminution, where the primary ophthalmologist saw a yellowish lesion in the macula and referred to rule out a metastasis, because she is a known case of carcinoma and still undergoing treatment. So if you look closely, the right eye macula shows a well-defined yellowish lesion, but look adjacent to it and you look at the optic nerve head, you'll see this hyperemia of the optic nerve. And if you look surrounding the optic nerve, it is still shows some signs of inflammation. The catch point is, if you do an FFA, it shows a typical leaking thing, leaking optic nerve head. So typical leaking optic nerve head will never be seen in a metastasis of the choroid until unless the lesion is involving the optic nerve. So to confuse you, I am going to present another case which is just adjacent to the first picture and is almost similar looking. So if you look at the first picture, this is what the case is. And if you look in the second picture, it is almost a similar looking lesion, but look closely, the disc is normal. There is no hyperemia. And the lesion in the macula is not well defined. You will see some satellite lesions in the superior edge of the lesions, too small. So clinical judgment is very important when you are seeing a case of presumed metastasis. And since this lesion is flat, almost flat, the best investigation modality for this is an OCT. So the first picture is our the lady who had a breast carcinoma. If you see the OCT, the RP layer is just showing elevated. The catch point is if you see multiple whitish hyper-reflective echoes which are present throughout the retinal layers. So these are inflammatory lesions. So this is very suggestive of inflammation, and this is a posterior scleritis mimicking as a mass. The second case, which the picture shows on the right side, if you see the RPE, it's undulation. And if you see the choroid at the back, it is back shadowing. So definitely this is the lesion present in the choroid, which is causing undulations in the front of the RPE and causing back shadowing. Presumably this is a choroidal mass, and this turned out to be a metastasis of the lung. So OCT is basically the treatment modality of choice in lesion less than 3 millimeters. Remember, the vitreous cells may not be visible clinically. Best to assess those inflammation is by OCT. Remember the rule of 30% of metastasis do not have history of carcinoma. So that is a very important point that has to be remembered.